Well, it's a very good morning to you, and thank you so much for waking up with us on Rush Hour. It's Tuesday and time now for Biz Clinic. And this week, for every business person, taking a risk is something you really have to look into, because they say risks and investments sometimes work. But if you're shipping goods across waters, then you might want to think otherwise, because in the event that anything happens, you could lose everything that you have on that ferry. Now, this morning, we'll be talking marine insurance and how the marine cargo insurance can protect traders that or importers that are shipping goods from China and other parts of the world. And to help me discuss that, I'm joined by Ambrose Chibuka, who is a technical committee member from Uganda Insurance Association. A very good morning to you, and thank you for joining me on set this morning.
Thank you.
For starters, why did the local marine cargo insurance take so long to get into effect?
Well, in all countries of the world, there is law and practice. So this requirement to insure goods coming into Uganda locally has always been on our laws, but we had not taken measures to implement it. Mm. Yeah, but now with support from the Ministry of Finance, lobbying through the Insurers Association, we've managed to get a directive from the ministry to implement this law and ensure that all imports coming into Uganda have Ugandan insurance. Because effectively what we were doing, we were donating the insurance premium from those goods to the countries of origin. So someone importing from India would get an insurance certificate from India, from China, from Europe, or wherever. But now all that premium will be domesticated and the importer is safer, because now he will, if he has a claim, if he has a problem with his goods, he's going to claim from an office in Kampala who speak English or Luganda, as opposed to having to get a Mandarin speaker or someone who speaks Chinese in order to lodge a claim. So it's taken long, yes, but we're now here.
All right, so let's talk a bit about what this generally then means for the insurance industry.
For the sector as a whole, this is a big, big development because we've assessed around $50 to $70 million in premium, basing on the volume of imports coming to Uganda. You know, Uganda is a net importer, so we bring in a lot of goods. So if we calculate the potential for insurance premium on those goods coming into Uganda, we look at a pot of about $50 to $70 million. Imagine the bump in revenues for the insurance sector and the ripple effects in terms of employment of employees to run this scheme, the ripple effect on tax contributions, because all insurance has a VAT element, a stamp duty element. It is a game changer for the sector, but also for the wider community.
I know you talked earlier about the fact that the importers can really, you know, come to the your offices, for instance, and claim if any. But maybe the question I'll ask, which is very basic really, is why is insurance important for guys shipping in?
Very good question. You see, when we call it marine insurance, what comes to mind is water.
That's right.
And indeed, the bulk of our imports, the goods we bring to Uganda, be they raw materials for industrialists or other cargo, comes through sea travel and then lands at, say, Mombasa or Dar es Salaam. Mm. And then there is a road transit to Kampala or wherever it's ending up in Uganda. Now, there have been typhoons, there have been ships that have sunk with people's goods, and they have nowhere to start. And their business, they were expecting certain stock, they were expecting certain raw materials, their business has to come to a halt. As they make new orders, they're losing money. Mm. So the risk involved with the transit of goods from their origin to Uganda, or even export of goods from Uganda to the rest of the world, there are risks on the road, there are risks on water. Mm. If you're sending the goods by air, there are risks in the air. All those risks are taken care of by marine insurance. Without the insurance, the importer or the exporter will have to bear the cost of any such fortuitous losses themselves. and it would be quite costly to them.
Does this come with any extra costs if I'm to work with an insurance company back in Uganda?
Actually, it comes with a discount.
Okay.
Yeah, so because of the anticipated volumes of imports we're going to be covering, we have managed to lock in a fairly discounted rate of premium so that we incentivize the importers especially to be able to come and take insurance from their Ugandan brothers and sisters in the insurance sector. So it doesn't come at a greater cost to the importer, but it brings lots of advantages, as I mentioned earlier, in terms of being able to deal with an underwriter or insurer who is regulated, governed, managed within Uganda.
Okay. Now, I know, like you said, it took a while before this really took off, and after 1st July, this financial, we saw it finally taking off. How does the picture look like so far?
Well, insurers have been very proactive. We knew that many of the potential people who want to insure don't know where to start. So we set up an online portal on uia.co.ug where you can go and serve yourself. You can upload commercial invoices, you can upload bills of lading and other details of your goods. You get an insurance pricing. You buy everything online. So this is making it easy for the consumer to be able to transact without even having to step out of their office or their home if they work from home.
So, you know, technology is really interesting. And you talk about the fact that, you know, importers can go on the portal and log whatever they want. Actually, there's a concern from the insurance brokers. Somehow, they're being kicked out of business by using this online stuff. How true is that?
Actually, that is not really true. We are partners. It's a sort of an ecosystem. There are the risk carriers, that is the insurers. Then there are what we call intermediaries, brokers, who go to the client and bring the client to the insurer. So the insurer has no interest in removing the broker. So what we've done, the portal does have a broking module. So there's a module where brokers can also serve their clients. They can log in and serve their clients still on the portal. So it has a window for the general public, the insuring public. It has a window for insurers and a window for intermediaries, in this case, brokers.
So for our traders that you know, might not really be able to speak good or English, whatever it is,
does
the portal cater for alternatives for them, or they really have to use English?
Well, the portal is in English. It's the trading language of the country and largely the world. However, you will find that if they are talking to a broker or an insurer to assist them, that person usually is multilingual. They can understand Luganda or whichever other language and English. So you can talk to your insurer in Luganda and he will do your policy in English and explain all terms and conditions to you.
That's interesting. Let's talk a bit about what an importer needs to have this work in terms of documentation. That's how they, maybe just take us through the steps of what they really need to have.
Yeah, so one primary assumption is that this importer is already registered with the URA. They have a TIN and all of that. So for a company to be registered on the URA, there will be certain details they would have provided already, their address, their nature of business, and many other details. So one of the key information you put in when you're issuing a policy on the portal is your tax identification number. Why? Because this system is integrated with the URA. The URA will be looking on the system to see whether these goods have a certificate. So we've integrated with the URA, and that also reduces the amount of information we ask from the client, because your phone number is already there in the URA system. The moment you put in the TIN, most details come. So the next step is then for you to now provide the particular details of your consignment. And those details are well known to importers. What is the nature of goods? What is the origin, the port of origin? What's the port of discharge? What's the nature of transportation? What's the nature of packaging? And all this information will be found on the invoice, commercial invoice, on the packing list, on the bill of lading, and the importers are well familiar with it.
Okay.
Talking to you as a journalist, you may think this is complicated information, mm-hmm. but this is what importers deal with mm-hmm. on a daily basis.
Okay. You did mention ERA somewhere. You know what? ERA and business people, there's always that conversation of taxes. Why do we have ERA in the system?
One, the URA requires that all goods entering Uganda must be insured. In the past, if your goods reached Uganda and you didn't have an insurance certificate, you would face a surcharge of 1% of the value of the goods. So that surcharge will now be avoided and you get real insurance, and the insurance rate is maybe about 20% of 1%. So you are reducing that, what would be surcharge by almost 80% by getting insurance as opposed to coming without insurance.
Okay.
So the ERA still is implementing the requirement for insurance, but the importer can have that at a much cheaper cost.
Okay. So let's just imagine an importer is trying to get into the system and they fail somehow, or they face difficulties, and you know how technology works sometimes, there's on
yes.
and off stuff.
Yes.
How do they get helped from there?
Very good. So if you're having challenges with the portal, we have a toll-free line always well displayed on our website, which one can call. You will not be charged for the cost of that call, but there will be someone on the other end to listen to you, guide you through. If the portal is difficult for you, the members, the 21 insurance companies who form the insurance association are still open. You can still go walk into an insurance office and get your policy from there. So it's not like we are telling people the only way you can buy insurance is through the portal. You can still buy insurance the traditional way. Mm. You can talk to your insurance broker. You can talk to your insurance company directly, and they will do the uploads for you.
Okay. I know the biggest, you know, number of people or group of people that you're targeting is really, let's say, Casita, for instance.
Yes.
How are you working with them to get them on board fully?
We have had engagements. Casita, we have talked to them. There, by the way, in this period, we've even come to learn there are so many other associations of importers. So we've been engaging with them every step of the way. We consulted with them on the portal. We've trained them on the portal. And these efforts are continuing. Even the campaign of coming to media houses and talking through this matter is in an effort to disseminate this information and hold the hand of our customers as they transition into this local marine insurance arrangement.
Okay. Well, in case you're joining us this morning, I'm speaking to Ambrose Chibuka, who is a technical committee member from Uganda Insurers Association. And we're discussing local marine insurance that took effect on 1st July 2022. Just how important it is for the importers, and looking at what just happened in Kenya, well, we know there's a president now, but between now and then, we're not very sure of what will happen. You know, does this maybe double confirm to importers that, look, you need this cover?
Exactly. Because just think of the risks that people have been running.
Mm.
It could well turn out to be a contested election and there is a protracted court process. And within 30 days, there are still tensions. If you have insurance, you would sleep better than one who doesn't have insurance and your goods are in Mombasa.
Mm. All right, then, let's talk a bit about, as we really come to the end, let's talk a bit about insurance in general. From where you sit, how does the sector look?
The sector is looking very good because we compare our growth to the economic growth of the country.
Mm.
In the last financial year, Uganda grew under 4% in terms of gross domestic product growth. But the insurance sector grew in double digits, over 10%, meaning we have weathered the storm of global economic downturns and remained resilient. The insurance sector is paying a lot of claims, be they medical claims, motor vehicle claims, in the billions of shillings, and therefore sorting out people who have suffered misfortune. We are delivering on the promise of insurance.
Your parting shots, Ambrose?
My parting shot would be to the general public, to tell them that By insuring in Uganda, you're supporting the Boo Boo campaign. Buy Uganda, build Uganda.
That's right.
But at the same time, we are a very well-regulated sector. Mm. So being a well-regulated sector means we will be able to deliver the promise. We're not just looking to collect premium. We are looking to provide insurance cover that will be real and keep your business afloat despite the eventualities that could befall your cargo.
Ambrose, thank you so much for speaking to us.
Thank you.
All right, Ambrose, they're from the Technical Committee of Uganda Insurance Association discussing local marine insurance and how it is important for you as importers. And of course, now you have to get the certification from Uganda and not China or any other country. It kind of works for you. So look into it and see how you can embrace it. Now, that's it on Biz Clinic for this week. Coming up on the big issue we are discussing, should the MPs have a bachelor's degree or should continue with, if they can make, you know, pass senior six, they can be leaders? Or do we care about services better than the qualifications? And of course, also, border borders in Kampala, the situation is going on. How important is it for them? For me and Ambrose here, it's good morning.